some individuals have found God and maintained their language at the same time.
That's true. You've had a pretty good week.
It's been a very interesting festival. It's not the kind of pattern that you sit at home and draw up unless you have a fantastic ego. I think mine is not quite that big, but if I were going to draw up a weekend, 12 Years a Slave, all this by my side, have the film shoot at the same time and then premiere back-to-back at Toronto, I think that would have been a pretty good plan.
So are you at peace with all the adulation? Are you...
Yeah, it's different.
Do you love
for both
being
of
loved?
Them. It's, I think with 12 Years a Slave, it's a little different because we're at a different film and a different subject matter, and what it was about was not as truly important, and not just self-important, but truly important. Mm-hmm. I think I would take more true glee out of everything that's happened with it, but I really feel, and I think everybody does with Solomon Northup's memoir, that you wanted to present it in the best fashion and that there's a response. That's good, it's gratifying, but if that book maintains a cultural density 5, 6, 10, 15 years from now, I think that's a different kind of reward. I think with All Is By My Side, yes, there is a straight joy for myself, for the crew that I had that was truly just so hardworking and gave so much to the cast that was not just phenomenal in their performances, but great people and worked hard, and to get that kind of response for them the first time that we've really shown it, that has, yes, filled me with schoolboy glee.
Is it, your career has been long now.
Yes.
You've been doing this a long time.
Yeah, there's a nice part where you can look back and go, yes, I have been doing it for a long time. I have made a career out of it. And hopefully, yeah, I can squeeze a few more years and a few more good stories out of it as well.
And a rather wide range of expectations.
I look at it in some ways now, even in this moment of the festival, that it really has been sort of a career in a couple of halves. In the early half, and I was younger, and the things that interest me had more abandon to them. If you look at U-Turn, if you look at Three Kings or Undercover Brother, they were fun and they were energetic, and a lot of them were written just in a fun, energetic space. Mm-hmm. And over the last few years, when I've had a family of my own, and you think about the things that you want to do and how you want to be perceived and what you want to leave for them, Red Tails and All Is By My Side and 12 Years a Slave and the film about the LA riots that I have coming up, where they do have a little bit more weight and import. The funny thing is, though, I do these things and you think, oh, you know, hopefully one day my kids will see these and they'll think of their dad did something, and my kids look at what I'm doing and they go, how come they're no robots? You know, how come they don't transform? You know, their mindset is completely different, so they're pushing me to, they're pushing dad, more robots. That's the key.
But they may grow out of that. I expect they'll grow out of that.
Well, the unfortunate thing, because of how long it takes to make a movie, by the time you get to that robot stage, they're like, Dad, why are you doing this frivolous stuff?
That's right.
Well, you see, my friend's dad, he does important movies. Why don't you do something important? So there's that, you kind of got to gauge it individually on what you want to do. But I think that for me, more than anything, for example, when we finished All Is By My Side on the last day, when I called cut on that last shot, and the first two people running to me were my kids, you know, that was really a gratifying experience to do it, to have them be able to not just see the film, but to see all these folks that were working together for a common goal. That was great.
Have you had a conscious focus or a direction in terms of your quote-unquote career, or is that kind of beyond reality that you've kind of...
I wish to a point I'd been savvy in any regard. If I'd been in any career, you want to look back and think, oh, I was smart enough to actually figure out what I want to do and how I want to do it. Mm-hmm. With me, it was sort of, again, I was young and this is what excited me and this is what I wanted to do, and people are just going to make this movie because I wrote it. Not even that it was good or had value, but you're just young and you figure, if I can write something, somebody's going to make it. And fortunately, to a degree, it happened. Mm-hmm. And it got into the right hands where that material was good. And simultaneously, I was writing novels and I was writing television and built up this body of work. There does come a point, I think, when you get a little savvier as a person and just a little more mature, and you realize that it really does take a lot of work, not just on the page. I've been very fortunate because I've been a good writer, but in that construction, who is it going to? Who are these people? Are they going to care as much? You realize how much it does take to make a film, in particular after 2007, when the economy changed, both in the greater world and in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. And if you are going to try to get some things done, how do you make those approaches? And these last mm-hmm. few films have been under a bit of a different model, both in terms of the financing, in terms of the individuals that I've been able to work with. But I think those choices have been better. But it has been, as you said when we first sat down, because you do get a career, mm-hmm. and you do get to look at it in parts and go, okay, that part worked. How do I build on this, both career-wise and for the things I really want to do now?
So it's interesting because we're in a period where there's a lot of people who like to say, oh, I couldn't have made that movie now. I can't make this movie now. Nobody would make this movie now. Yeah. And yet you've been involved with a number of movies that are exactly the kind of movies they claim can't be made now.
Yeah.
And you've found, I mean, it's not the same way they may have been made 10 years ago, but yeah. they've gotten made.
I think if there's one attribute that I have is that I think I'm too dumb to know that that movie can't get made. And I'm in that, you know, I'm kind of kidding on the square, but I think if you come into and go, I can't get that done and I can't get that made, well, then you're not. Are you going to go to a financier and go, here's a movie you probably don't like, or here's something I don't think there's going to be
not
much
a good
box
pitch.
Office to it? No, and you can't blame somebody
yeah.
if you're sitting down with them and they feel that there's no real need for this, either from a critical standpoint, we're going to make something that people are going to respond to in that fall time period, or a financial standpoint. And by the way, those two ideas are not antithetical to each other.
Mm-hmm.
With 12 Years a Slave, certainly with Steve, he's a guy who sits down and says, we're going to make this. With Plan B, they were like-minded. And for me, and that, you know, that was a spec script. I didn't get paid up front for that, but it mm-hmm. was, this is a great idea. Once Steve got the book and put it in my hands, it was like, this is fabulous. Let's go do this and make it. And it was the same thing with Always by My Side. You know, it was mm-hmm. a spec situation. But I just sat down with people and really looked them in the eye and said, I'm making this movie. I know other people have failed. It's hard to do a Hendrix biopic. I don't care. I'm making it. And I think people really do respond to that level of faith in yourself, in the material, and the people that you begin to collect with you.
Well, you've been, I mean, there was a time where the spec market was very hot, but you've been kind of a specky guy. I mean, even if you just take your novels or your, you know, yeah. you've kind of always put the work foot forward.
I think you have to.
Most of the time.
A lot of times as writers, and I think rightly so, we, particularly with film, you know, we complain because we don't get historically treated as well as others who come onto the film, that we don't mm-hmm. have as much ownership of it, that always you hear the stories about the notes that come in that are completely different from where the writer started or where they want to go or what kind of story they want to tell.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's one thing to complain about that, and it's another thing to do something about it. And for me, because I really love to write, I really enjoy it, aside from whether it's going to sell. And I mean, I got scripts all over that will never sell. Some of them, they probably should never sell. Mm-hmm. But others where I feel like it's just, it's going to the gym and working out and finding things and testing myself. But to have that material and be able to say to someone, here's what I want to do, and if you want to do it, these are my terms. If you don't, you don't. No harm, no foul. Mm-hmm. But if you do, it needs to be like this and like this and like this. And you can certainly offer that up, and at some places they're going to go, well, if that's what you want, we're not going to give it to you.
Mm-hmm.
But if you keep doing that, I think you get to a point, certainly you look at Always by My Side. I mean, that was the culmination of years of working, of being insistent, and finally getting to the place where I would like to do this film my way, mm-hmm. the way this is written, with these people around me, with these actors, because I really love them. And I think if that film works at all, it's because you feel that sense of ownership of everybody. But it only gets that to that place if you own it coming into the situation.
When a lot of people trying to go down that road where you actually got there.
Yeah. And I, you know what, I applaud the people for it because it's not an easy road. You can't kid yourself. Like I said, I've got plenty of scripts that are never going to see the light of day. But it is, I think, even in, as I move forward, honing it down to, okay, every script you write isn't going to get somewhere, but what are those couple that you feel so passionately about? It reads, you feel the passion on the page,
mm-hmm.
you feel it in the pitch, and then ultimately, hopefully, the audience feels that on the screen as well. But I truly, for those people who are in a place where, you know, I don't know what I want to do or where I want to go, I encourage them to go and sit and write. If nothing else, it just feels good in the process.
Mm-hmm. So where did 12 Years start for you?
12 Years started, Steve McQueen and I have the same agents. We're at the same agency, and they mm-hmm. had a screening of Hunger. So this was 5 years ago or so.
5 or 6, yeah.
5 or 6 years ago. And normally I don't go to screenings at the agency. They don't, you never know what you're going to get. It's a mixed bag. But I went because of the subject matter. I remember Bobby Sands from when I was much younger, and I thought it was fascinating. Steve had read a manuscript that I had written. He really enjoyed it. We sat down for breakfast the next morning, and among the things we talked about, Steve was very specific, wanted to do a story in that time frame of American history. Didn't want it to be a straight slave narrative. Wanted a protagonist who had a particular station and intelligence and an artistic ability, and that was taken from him. He wanted something that was on a large geographical and emotional canvas, all of these things, but he didn't have the book, and I didn't know anything about this book. You know, as an American, I'd never heard of it, didn't really know the story, found out later that there'd been a version of it done, but was not one that was very much in the American psyche. We went back and forth on some ideas. I found some things and pitched them to him and read a lot about that time and that era, but there was nothing that stuck. And his wife found this book, and she said to him, why don't you just do this? He read it. He thought it was great. He gave it to me. I read it. I said, this is fantastic. If this is what you want to do, I would love to do it. We had also both known Jeremy Kleiner at Plan B, and we'd known him separately, and Jeremy was fantastic in that he was very encouraging. They didn't have money for development, but he said, you know, if you can go write this script and you can make it work and you can make Steve happy, we will find a way to get this movie made. And you hear that a lot, you really do, particularly when it's a free situation. People are always telling, if you just go write this, we'll find a way to get you paid.
Just go do the work, we'll take care of it.
6 years later, we'll give you something. But this was not 6 years later. Once I finished writing, it happened immediately, and everyone at Plan B, they were good to their word. They found a way to get it made, not just made, but made at one of the highest levels I've seen for any kind of film, but a film that, you know, this, relatively speaking, was modestly budgeted.
So you wrote, and then Steve and you started talking, or did Steve know talk to you while you were writing?
Yeah, when we found the book, or when Steve found the book, and Steve got the book to me, and I read it, at that point, we sat down and we started going through the book page by page. We had met previously and we'd talked about film and cinema and shared some different films that we really liked. There was an issue in that I live in Los Angeles, Steve lives in Amsterdam, so those meetings were spread out over time. They were very intense when we met in the sense that we didn't have a lot of time together, so we had to make the most of it. But we had very many conversations. Steve was he has an amazing amount of clarity of the things that he's looking for and the things that he wants, but also has an amazing capacity to leave this very large creative space of how do you feel and what would you like to try to achieve. So we went through the book page by page, and Steve really distilling the things that were interesting to him and where he thought a lot of the emotion lay, and then left it to me to go off and put that plot together. The plot was to a degree self-evident, but the narrative was not structured in a way that I think a 2013 audience is used to. It's just was a different style of writing. So there was a bit of that fundamental creation of what that narrative is. That was, you know, it's what you do when you adapt. The most difficult thing was the language. It was arcane in places, elevated in others. Some places the dialogue was fully formed, others it was not there at all. And that became a restoration project, trying to put that together and ultimately just have sort of an invisible hand, not overwrite it to the point where, oh, look at how clever John is with those lines. You know, a 2013 line would stand out.
All right.
It needed to be in that 1853 vernacular and style. And that was, it was a challenge, but it was a lot of fun doing it.
Well, so much of it is the restraint of Solomon's character.
Yeah.
In what he doesn't say, and when he doesn't say it, when he decides to speak, is a lot of the narrative.
It really is an interesting construction from the script itself to what you see on the screen. And I think Steve is one of those few people who has enough confidence in everything around him, the way it's framed, what the actors can do, as you say, verbally or non-verbally, to let a scene sit in a spot where here you just take in the beauty, or here an individual says what needs to be said with looks and glances. There's one moment in particular where Solomon is listening to Bass and Epps talk about slavery and freedom, and Solomon knows this may be his last opportunity with this individual. He says nothing in that scene but that nervousness as he's listening to this debate, and do I trust this individual? these actors, what they can do without saying anything, I think it's very, very brave. And then on the other side, when there are moments and you have pages, I mean, truly, pages of dialogue and people interacting, and it gets very emotional and it's almost theatrical in its styling, but they have the capacity to bring a level of honesty where it doesn't sound like theater. Mm-hmm. You believe these are folks in and of that era really speaking and connecting.
When you really need, when you do have him speaking, and he is, I don't know that he's expressing it so much as it's being expressed to the audience, the level of his education and intelligence,
yeah.
But you only have a few lines, it's an interesting, you know, because as you say, it could become very flowery or, you know, trying too hard.
Yeah, I mean, and that was the thing. I mean, honestly, that was one of those things coming in, because I think even for audiences, I don't think a lot of people really understand that in that time frame, there were free black people. You know, and they were freed. Slaves were freed, but there were free black people, and they had station, and they had education, and they were of the highest regard in their communities. Mm-hmm. So I think just intuitively, not that anyone is wrong in that thinking, but you come into it and go, oh, this sounds more like a caricature than a character. So I think actually in some of that construction where you get to see Solomon, you get to spend time with him, and then you hear him speak. And then you see other individuals like Eliza, who is of station, and her language is elevated. And in fact, those first people of color that we meet as Northerners who've been kidnapped, mm-hmm. their language is a bit more elevated. And as you go southward, it becomes a bit more base, but mm-hmm. at the same time, it sets up that dynamic of there were individuals who had something, it was robbed from them. There were other individuals who have not had the opportunity to be educated, willfully have been mm-hmm. uneducated, because should they be educated, there's that opportunity for them to want to free themselves.
Mm. And the possibility of them being killed for just that.
That was the other thing. And you know, to your point earlier about Solomon, when he says things and when he doesn't, always being mindful of those moments, if he speaks too well, if he says too much, if he reveals too much of his own knowledge, that is death. And it's instant death. Not, mm-hmm. you know, there's no trial involved. Mm-hmm. You're smart, you die.
Yeah. And I mean, also I think that the capture of Solomon, I guess, I don't know, the kidnapping of Solomon
yeah.
is done in a way that's relatively subtle.
Yeah.
And not defined as much as you would, and certainly not in a current movie, in a 2013 kind of movie.
Yeah.
But I think it also makes it even more universal, because it does it put me in the mind, at least, the plight of the current being a black man in America, you know, and being guilty of walking in a neighborhood while black and that kind of thing, that still is yeah. hovering, even though it's not as expressed as it was in the movie.
It's certainly not the same as it used to be in the movie, but
yeah.
there is, and as you know, these conversations about the conversations we need to have, and those haven't gone away. I'm thankful that we're in a place now where perhaps we could have those conversations. I think personally the people who need to have the conversations unfortunately don't. I think there's so many people now who there's no need for that conversation because of the kinds of people that they spend time with and the real conversations they're having about kids or lawn care or football or whatever, you know, those are the conversations different kinds of people need to have, because you realize, you know what, you're not that different from me. You're sort of the same as me. But as you say, in this story, what happens is subtle. What happens is very targeted, and you do look at life in 2013 and you do see situations where people are targeted and things happen because they are different. It's unfortunate that in this space it still happens. It does give me hope that because when these things happen they become so elevated, we realize that it's wrong and we need to do something about it. Mm. A film like this, you know, I hope and believe it'll touch people. I think it's always a little much to say, well, this film is going to change a truly hardened heart. But for people who have the capacity to look and see and just learn, I think this, all of us can improve a little bit. And if nothing else, if you come out of that and think about how we treat other people on a daily basis, not even about things about race or sexual orientation or things like that, just on a common basis, you know, mm-hmm. you know what, it wouldn't hurt to be a little more courteous. It wouldn't hurt to give people a break and not bring my presuppositions to the table. If you can at least do that mm-hmm. for a bit, I think that we've really accomplished something. And added to that, then, if people rediscover the story, if they go out and read the memoir, which I would encourage, because as fantastic as a film as it is, you know, it's limited to 2.5 hours, and mm-hmm. this story is so rich and so deep and so emotive, I would really want everyone to do a favor, do themselves a favor, and go ahead and read the memoir.
Mm-hmm. One of my favorite moments also when somebody who is a good person in the movie is questioning whether doing something good is safe enough for them.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the story we're dealing with Syria right now in the you know, in the Congress. We're dealing with all these issues and where, you know, that's the real for the people who actually are a little more evolved, I guess.
Yeah,
it's still a question.
It is, and it's like how far do we stick our necks out for anything, whether it's just emailing your politicians, whether it's whatever you believe in, I'm actually going to go out and vote. You know, to me, that's the wild thing. We live in a country, look at other countries, and they want their freedoms. They're out in the streets. People are fighting and dying for that. But we, as people, there's so many things that, in America in particular, that upset us and that we talk about and we have the ability to talk about, but we do those fundamental things. Do we stick our neck out? You certainly look back in that, in the film, in that era, and I think any rational person looks at those characters and go, oh, why don't you just do it, help them, you gotta help them. Mm-hmm. But then you have to remember that, yeah, that person could be killed as well. And then line that up with the fact that in 2013, we're upset about this, we're outraged about that, but you know, I really don't have the time to do much. Well, maybe there's an online petition and I'll do that. And by the way, I put myself at the top of that list. Mm-hmm. I'm no better than most people. When there are causes, when there are things that we can get involved with, how deep, how far do we go? We certainly know one person can back every single cause, but if there is something you really believe in, and if there is that moment where you feel like, well, maybe I shouldn't do this because, not even so much of get in trouble at work, obviously mm-hmm. you gotta be mindful of bringing your politics to work, but on a Sunday, you know, am I out doing something proactive for somebody? Mm-hmm. You know, am I teaching my kids that there's, you know, yes, there's poverty or there's injustice, but what are we doing as a family to go change things? That is a lesson coming from this film. Whatever you believe, if there's a level of right and true and honesty to it, then yeah, you should be out being proactive and not just leaving it to others.
It's amazing how we are in a period where more tools for communication than ever, and yet in some ways that's almost like stifled more serious communication. Well, you know, everything's kind of left to the surface and there's a lot of it, but.
Yeah, the fact that you can communicate, and I will say this about 12 Years a Slave, because one of the elements of storytelling that was really powerful to me was that lack of communication. A lot of that story is mm-hmm. about him just trying to write a letter to people who could vouch for him and help him. Mm-hmm. And it's something we do take for granted. You can write emails and tweet and Facebook and Instagram, and there's so many ways to get it out there, and people love to get everything out there, but what are we putting out there? You know, sometimes more is not better, and that's not an indictment on the ability to do these things, but are those things that we're putting out among the fun things, among the cute things, how much of that are we putting out that it really has an impact? And not just globally, but if you can tweet, you know, how many times you tweeting your kids mm-hmm. or your family or whatever and just saying, hey, thinking of you and all this and that. For Solomon Northrup, and that was something that was really impactful to me. He had an opportunity to leave a letter for his wife. He thought, well, I'll be back by the time she's back. There's no need. And he spent 12 years regretting that. Mm-hmm. So when we have these tools, I do think it's great. You can just share almost anything with anybody. But in that space, if you're not sharing something that is, you know, truly meaningful, why don't you share a little something, a little nugget with people that you care about? Because it's, you know, you never know. And I hate to be a fatalist like that, but, you know, just take that couple of seconds and connect, really connect.
Well, thanks to Twitter, you've already won the Oscar, so.
Jeez. That, you know, I mean, there's, again, there are moments in your life when you wish you were just part of the conversation. You know, that element of Hollywood and peer review takes care of itself, but people are lying if they don't say at some point they didn't consider what it would be like to be part of the conversation. And now, when all of that, all of 12 Years a Slave is so far ahead of the conversation, you're like, wow, just on the level of prognostication feels good, but just that people feel that way at all, mm-hmm. however it shakes out, that for a moment they felt that strongly about this film and about my involvement with it, it's truly overwhelming, and it's really gratifying.
And you have gold with you.
And, yes.
It got a little crazy the night of the movie. I mean, as great as the movie is, it's like, after a while you're like, oh my God, enough already.
So yeah, it's...
Let's not kill the goose before it lays the golden egg.
Yeah, it's a bit much, and I think people are... You know, it's interesting because you have that moment, and then now at this time of year, every film that comes out is suddenly, you know, this one takes the race and all this and that. I think it's nice. I think the way... That's certainly the way people have tried to line up these festivals and line up the awards season, and I think that's great for people who really enjoy and watch film, that they can... feel like they have more skin in the game than perhaps it's just out there happening around them. So we'll see, but I really am just thankful to be part of the conversation, even if it's just for this week.
And I guess you would be thankful to have Steve McQueen, the Steve McQueen experience.
You know, being able to meet Steve coming off of Hunger when he wasn't the Steve that everyone has come to know and realize what an artist he is, what a talent he is, how provocative he likes to be, and not just provocative politically, but in terms of where he wants to take cinema. To be able to watch that happen, to be able to be in that space as it happens, and by the way, also to be around people like Sean Bobbitt, his DP, and Joe Walker, his editor, and to see how they treat and use cinema. That's been very spectacular because you don't often get to be in a space where all of these people are on an upward trajectory. And for me, fortunately as well, to be in a space where I think I'm going to another level of my career, not just in terms of the writing, I hope the writing is maturing, but in terms of also what I want to do and how I want to say it. So that has been fantastic for me because it's just been a very wonderful, comforting, and safe place to be over the last 3 or 4 years.
What's interesting is people have this kind of very intense experience of what's in the movie, whether it be the whippings or whatever, and at the same time, in some ways, it's almost like Steve has matured into a more restrained filmmaker. And it's not that he wasn't restrained before, but he had this kind of freedom to have these big things, and there's kind of, I guess, his respect for this subject and the material.
Yeah.
He's reined it in so that it's all very condensed and doesn't feel
it's focused.
Painful. I mean, Hunger is a hard, hard movie to watch.
Yeah, Hunger is hard, Shame is hard, and you certainly have to come into it with a mindset of you're prepared for that kind of movie. And to a degree, 12 Years a Slave as well, but there are these moments that are so lovely when Lupita is just making that doll out of corn husks and creating that family of dolls, and you just, it says everything so brilliantly, but it's such a quiet moment, and it's such a reserved moment, and it's a focused, beautiful piece of storytelling. And when people talk about Steve, in my opinion, and they say he has an unflinching style, I think in the back of your mind you go, oh, I'm unflinching because something bad is going to happen, he's not going to turn away. But I think it's unflinching because also when something beautiful happens, he doesn't just rush through it to get to the more meatier storytelling. He realizes that those character beats or those really intimate moments have equal weight and is willing to sit and not flinch from those either. And honestly, I think that in some ways is the more difficult type of storytelling because we all want to see those, as painful as they might be, whether it's a smaller independent film, whether it's a big blockbuster, you want those big set pieces. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes people don't realize to get to those moments and to have them have any kind of weight, you need those smaller moments and you need to sit in them for a bit.
Well, everybody, I mean, I think on most films, everybody is committed to doing the, you know, the best they can in terms of bringing it together, but there's something about this film where you go, every piece of the puzzle feels like the level of commitment seems just absolute.
Yeah.
And completely given into what the goal is, ultimately.
I really think it goes back to Solomon's work, the memoir, and what he says and how he says it and the fact that it has an immediacy that many, first of all, there aren't that many slave narratives because unfortunately people who were slaves could not read or write. So to have an individual who had a capacity for storytelling to begin with, to go through this experience, to write it within a few years of his being freed, that immediacy and that emotion, it's on the page. And I think for everyone who, in the production, who was able to read the memoir or at very least go through the script thoroughly and get that experience coming out on the other side of it, yes, absolutely, they felt that sense and that desire and that need to bring every single thing to it, not just make a good movie, because everybody does, as you say, we all go into it wanting to make a good movie, but ensuring that this movie was going to be good, solid, and emotive, and within that then people can say great. You know, that's for other people to say, oh, this is great or this is fantastic. We're all going to do the absolute best that we can. And in that, when you've got 150 people doing the best that they can, yes, you're going to end up with a movie that others will then say, that's great.